Pierce Freelon, welcome to the In the Moment Studios here in Sioux Falls. Thank you for stopping by.
Thank you for having me. I love Sioux Falls so far, and the studio is awesome.
And you have met some of our kids, right? You're already reading stories to them and working with them. Tell me a little bit about what you've been up to this week ahead of your performance this weekend at the Lovett.
Sure. Well, I was at Ace Academy. Not only were we reading storybooks together, but we were also making beats.
Nice.
So if you could imagine a room full of, you know, elementary, preschool age kids on like an electronic drum machine, you know, making boom, ching, boom, boom, ching, making their own little beats and then rapping about things that they care about.
Yeah.
This one kid's like, I'm on a bicycle on the sidewalk. I'm on a bicycle on the sidewalk. Just super cute. Another girl wrote a song about her favorite food. Potatoes.
Oh, nice.
It was so cute. So the kids of Sioux Falls are cool with me. They were amazing. I was at the YMCA yesterday. We did a summer camp at Augie. Like, we've just been all over the place with Lovett. And I've really enjoyed getting to know the community through your kids.
Yeah, that's what Lovett is all about. It's not just the stage. It's not just the performance. It is this deep connection with community and music and inviting people to participate in it. I'm so glad. And your work, you do so much. Okay, let's just get to the fact that we're not going to get to everything that Pierce Freelon is. But I have just a passion for children's music and children's literature. And when my daughter, she's all grown up now, but when she was little, it was those children's CDs. I felt like I was reparenting myself in some ways. And I was also learning how to be a parent because a song would come up about kindness or a song would come up about, you know, riding your bicycle. And it just helped me figure out what she was thinking at the same time. Why is music that's family friendly, not vapid music, but really smart, layered, intelligent music for kids? Why is that important to you?
Well, it's important to me as a parent. Like you, I've raised little ones who are getting older. My son just graduated middle school, which is mind-boggling. It's like, high schooler.
Here it comes.
Everybody says it goes fast, but it's so true. But, you know, raising little kids, they're sponges. They absorb everything. And it wasn't until I became a parent that I started listening critically to the music that I enjoy. You know, I grew up in the 90s, so there was like a lot of hip-hop that I was listening to that, you know, I like the beat, I like the lyrics, I'm rapping along. Now all of a sudden I'm a parent, I've got two kids on the back, I'm like, oh, let me turn the volume down on that particular song, you know, and I'm like, well, what can I play that is a reflection of my culture that has the same feel that makes you want to, you know, groove in your seat while you're driving them to the grocery store, you know, but has lyrics that are appropriate and ideas and topics that are relevant to their lives. And I didn't find a lot, not a lot in the hip hop space, not a lot from the perspective of a father. There's a lot of children's musicians who are women and children's picture book authors that are women. And then, you know, there's this weird paradox where, like, you know, people are surprised to see, like, fathers as primary caregivers and as nurturers. I just remember going to the park and people would be like, oh, you're such a great dad. Look at you with your little kitty. You know, your kid's in a backpack and you're pushing the stroller. Aren't you just a great dad? I'm like, this is kind of the bare minimum, actually. You know, we're just out and about, just like nobody's giving my wife props when she's like doing basic mom stuff. But there's I think it's because there's a dearth of, we don't see it often in the media. So for me, as a children's music artist, I wanted to show fatherhood and vulnerability through fatherhood, playfulness, caregiving as a dad, as a black father, you know, particularly with black masculinity and the stereotypes associated with it, kind of nurturing, loving goofball isn't really in the equation as much as it should be. So that's what I just noticed when I started writing and releasing songs, that like, wow, there's really nothing out here that's like this.
Did that mean there was an opening for you that you were able to step into, or did you have to convince other people, the gatekeepers, that there was a need that needed to be filled?
Well, you know, I'm lucky. I come from a creative and, dare I say, audacious family. I didn't ask anyone for permission. I showed up in my fullness unapologetically, and, you know, and it was embraced. And I think that I released my first children's music album in 2020. The timing was really interesting. I think there was a moment for dads that year for a couple of reasons. There was a short film called Hair Love, which is also a book by Matthew A. Cherry, who's a
Oscar winner, right?
Oscar winner that year. And that was a story about a black father, you know, and not, you know, not like, I don't know, like I grew up with, you know, shows like The Cosby Show and, you know, Family Matters, and they had these older black fathers who were physicians. And, you know, this guy in Hair Love was like a young dad with locks, like me. He had tattoos on his arms. I related to this dude. And here he is, like, trying to figure out his daughter's hair. And it was an Oscar winner, and I felt seen, you know, for the first time. I'd never seen a dad as a primary giver in a Disney-type style animation before. You know, mom nowhere to be found until the end of the episode. And also that year, this was 2020. That was the year Kobe Bryant tragically passed away in the helicopter accident with his daughter. And I remember seeing, you know, throughout the media, there was like tons of images of Kobe nurturing his daughter, showing her basketball, you know, reading her books and being caring. And for the previous, you know, 20 years, we saw a lot of Kobe dunking, you know, being very masculine and Mamba mentality. But because of the nature of this particular tragedy, the media was all of a sudden flooded with this fatherhood, this intimate, close, soft, black masculinity. And I was like, wow, I didn't, it's not that that version of him didn't exist. It's just that the media isn't as interested in telling that story. So that happened to be the year that I released DAD. And I feel like in the zeitgeist, there was a yearning for, you know, this was also the summer of George Floyd. There was a yearning for black men to be seen as whole human beings that include that softness that comes with being a parent. At least that's how I was parented, and how my dad and his dad and his dad, you know, they were loving. And, I didn't see that as much in the media. And I felt like the timing of the album, my first album, really resonated with, you know, a moment in American pop culture.
Yeah. So here we are just ahead of Father's Day, and I'm sure some people are listening and thinking about their complicated relationships with their father, but you and I have both lost our fathers, and so for us, Father's Day has a different kind of celebratory nature, but also this pairing with grief. And your mother, Nina Freelon, has a just profound podcast called Great Grief, which I would highly recommend to anybody. Where she has conversations with grief that I sit down and I'm like, yeah, no, I haven't done that yet. Like, oh, yep, Nina, I needed to hear that, because that is what I've been avoiding, you know, for these few years. As you approach your own fatherhood and you approach your own father, who was a well-known architect, who was a giant in his community, who died of ALS, you watched him lose his voice. You walked through that anticipatory grief with him, like, how do you approach Father's Day now from where you stand?
Yeah, well, you know, you mentioned my mom's podcast. You know, the lessons that she offered, that she learned through her grieving, are also lessons that were a part of our family and the culture of how we moved through my dad's from diagnosis, you know, to death and afterwards. And I feel, honestly, genuine enthusiasm about Father's Day. I feel his presence daily. It doesn't scare me. It doesn't evoke a sense of like, you know, I think of grief as love. It is a version of love. In fact, if you don't feel grief when someone dies, that's because the relationship wasn't close. If you were super close, then the grief is actually an expression. It's a part of love, the depth and the width of your relationship is reflected in the feeling of loss when they're gone. So that is sitting with it, sitting with the loss, looking at it, dancing with it, engaging with it, and recognizing it as love fills my heart with gratitude, you know, and that's what I feel. I'm looking forward to being with my dad on Father's Day, you know, energetically. I know he's with me in spirit. I feel his energy. When I look in the mirror, when I feel myself pulling some of the phrases that used to annoy me as a kid, and I'm using those same phrases on my kids, put down the ding-dong remote. He would say ding-dong. Ding-dong. That was like his expletive replacer. And the other day, I was at the I was in the kitchen with the kids, and I told my son to put down the ding-dong something. And I was like, oh, Dad.
Here you are. Welcome. Yeah.
Yeah, like, okay, nice to see you, Dad. Way to show up in you know, in a tense moment to bring some levity and remind me that you'll always be with me.
Yeah.
And that's because I love him, and I still love him, and I am grateful for everything that he gave me. So I'm looking forward to Father's Day.
When you make music for children, you want to weave in, I've heard you say, an attitude of gratitude.
Mm-hmm.
Boundaries. Yep. No is a love word.
No is a love word.
I have not heard that before.
Ooh.
That's nice stuff.
Mm-hmm, mm-hmm.
And vulnerability.
Yeah.
I mean, that's, I don't know. Some of that's new to me. I want to say some of it's Fred Rogers. Some of it's just, you know, being human. But some of it is a brand new. Some of it feels very contemporary to me. What is important in children's music without being pedantic or heavy-handed to help kids feel empowered to say no, you know, to have bodily autonomy, to have, to know their own thoughts, to create something and say that is my song about a bicycle and therefore it can be in the world. Mm-hmm. How do you help kids become audacious like you and your family are?
Well, you know, it's interesting. So in my time here in Sioux Falls, Ace Academy was the first, and that was littles, right? Like small kids.
Yeah.
And then we went to a middle school where there was a summer camp, and those kids were, you know, 12, 11, 10, mm-hmm. older. And the kids at Ace, very audacious, fearless. They popped up, they made beats, they grabbed the mic, they did lyrics, they laughed, had a ball. By the time we got with the middle schoolers, there was a lot more trepidation. There was a lot more self-consciousness and reluctance to engage.
Yeah.
So I don't think our job as parents is to teach kids to be audacious. They are that way by their nature.
Yeah.
The key is to nurture it. It's to support it. It's to allow them to feel so loved that they're not afraid to be themselves, especially in front of their peers, mm-hmm. which becomes harder the older they get. As they become more self-aware, you know, how do I really feel comfortable in my own skin? And my parents did a great job of that. I think the number one key is the same thing as the grief. It's love. If you love up on your kids and they feel confident in themselves, then they will feel bold enough to be themselves, just like that intrinsic boldness of the younger mm-hmm. kids.
These are kids who probably know who George Floyd is. These are kids who are probably never going to forget COVID
mm-hmm.
and how it impacted their lives. When we talk about loss or big emotions for kids, I mean, losing a favorite toy, losing mm-hmm. a friend mm-hmm. who moved away, losing the daylight when it's time to go to bed.
Right.
These can feel huge to them.
Yeah.
How in your music do you help kids deal with the big stuff?
Yeah. So I have a song, not on my album. This is my friend Mills Trill's album. We have a song called Let Me Have My Feelings. And
I like that.
Ooh, it's a good one. And you know, and my daughter Stella, I will say she taught me this. You know, Stella is a lot more emotive than I am. And my inclination when there is a meltdown is like, get it together. We're not going to have a meltdown in the middle of this grocery store. And she's just like, I can't control when these big feelings are going
right.
to hit me. Like, you need to be here with me. Like, you're either with me or against me. That's what the feelings are telling. And I had to learn over time that this is how she's asking to be cared for. Mm. So, interestingly enough, the other day, she was having a meltdown, a whole meltdown. She and my wife were going at it. And I said, and I had a moment of like, oh, let me get in and fix this. And I had to pump the brakes for a second. I said, wait, nope, tried that. Let me actually just be with her in her feelings. Mm. So I sat down on the couch. I put my arm around her. She wept into my, you know, shoulder. And, you know, I was just kind of humming and rocking, you know, and she let it out as I was rubbing her back. And she was venting, and I let her vent. And I said, hey, you want to play some ping pong? She said, okay, can I serve first? I said, you can serve first. Let's go upstairs and play ping pong. We went up, we played ping pong. You know, 30 minutes later, she had a poofy face, but she was like, she had, was able to re-regulate. And then the next day, we talked about, you know, I did the parenting. I didn't just leave the inappropriate aspects of her behavior, some of the things she was saying, were a little out of pocket. I had to address it. But, you know, if you try to address that kind of thing in the moment, they're not going to hear you. They're in their feelings at that moment. At least she wouldn't have.
Right.
So it's even as a from a parenting tool, it is more effective to attempt to reach them when their, you know, blood pressure is lower, when the adrenaline is out of their blood, when they're able to breathe, you know. Then they can actually hear what you have to say and can engage you on the things that they need to learn. But in that moment, yeah, let me have my feelings. The song rings in my ear now when I think about parenting her in particular. My son is a little different, but, you know, that let me have my feelings piece has been something that even I didn't learn that until after the song. I wrote the song because it was like, you know, but, you know, practicing what you preach isn't so easy.
Right.
So I learned after the song that, like, oh, this is what I was writing about and singing about. Like, ooh, you know, it's tough in the moment sometimes, for me at least. So, yeah, I think that's a big lesson is to let kids feel, let them know that they're safe to feel however they feel with you.
You mentioned earlier children's books, maybe not seeing yourself reflected, and you have two children's books?
Yeah, two children's books, yep.
There's some outdoor themes, there's some camping, we're going to go fishing. Like, that is another really important thing that often people don't see in children's literature, is just spending time in nature and sitting. Why was that something that you wanted to address in your book?
Yeah, well, you touched on something not just important in the children's space, but I'll just go to underscore me as a black father. I think there are certain stereotypes about black folks as primitive, as you know, uneducated, you know, that stem from enslavement and before, where, you know, European colonists were looking at Africa as like this jungle. And, you know, for those and other reasons, there are stigmas that still exist about, you know, our relationship to nature and how we engage with the natural world that are kind of steeped in these troublesome stereotypes. So for me, yeah, writing a book about going camping, about really claiming some of the rituals around, you know, building a fire and finding a worm to pierce on a hook and cast a line and to cook your catch over an open flame. These things are a part of our story too, but we don't see it enough. And another important aspect of the book is about memory. The nature walk that the father and the son are on was a nature walk that the father had taken with his dad when he was a kid. Mm-hmm. And so as they're walking through the forest and listening to the birds and the frogs, the father is telling his son, you know, Pop-Pop used to take me out to this very same spot. And, you know, sometimes when I just sit here on this log and close my eyes, I can still feel his presence. Like, and then, you know, the boy's like, you know, I miss him. And it's like, it's okay to feel like, you know, let it out Yeah. Like, I'm here. And they're going through this vulnerable remembering together. And that's another thing, I think, for men and for Black men in particular, that that you don't see enough. There's a lot of, you know, toughen up, you know, like boys don't cry. There's a lot of stereotype around masculinity as strength means don't show emotion. And I think that has been, that narrative has been very harmful to men. We don't really know or have as many tools with which to process our emotions. And that creates some weird pathologies with men. So a children's picture book that tells a kid it's okay to feel, I think is so important for boys especially.
Yeah. Working with your mother as an adult, I love watching this from the outside. I love listening to it. Has it always been? I'm obviously it's not a perfect relationship because no relationship is, but what is your artistic synergy with your mom?
Well, my mom is my mentor. She, you know, made the courageous choice after I was born, and I'm the youngest of three, to pursue a career in music at 30, you know, with three kids, like, under three, you know, back to back. Sometimes, now, to be clear, I didn't realize this at the time. I'm just a baby. My mom, you know, she leaves the house. I don't know what she's doing for work. You know, it's just like, it was just her profession. But now as an adult, when I look back and I say, wow, you know, in 1980, you know, 88, 87, 86, when she was just getting started in her musical career, we were all very small kids. And there were narratives that she was dealing with about the age at which a woman is in her prime. I'm using air quotes here. There were things that she dealt with that were barriers to entry for her to start a career at that late, in air quotes, junction in her life. And I really admire the gall to look at the naysayers and say, nope, I'm doing a radical career shift right now to do what I love. And, you know, whether I knew the particulars at the time or not, I think energetically I was absorbing that same mentality of, you know, follow your passions and find something that you love to do, pour yourself into it. And, you know, as her career took off and she was nominated for, you know, now 6 Grammy Awards. She was a world traveler. She took me on tour with her. I traveled with her to Japan. She took me to Finland and across the country. And I'm doing homework, you know, during sound check. It's like I was saturated in this space. So both creatively and professionally, she showed me what it is to be an entrepreneur. She showed me what it is to be a businesswoman. She showed me what it is to be a full-time artist who makes her living on the wings of her music. All of that was my blueprint growing up. And, you know, I've taken those lessons and observations and internalized them into my blueprint, you know, following in her footsteps. And creatively, the dynamic is, you know, I'm in the children's space. She's a jazz vocalist, but I have training in jazz and was in a jazz band.
Yeah.
And she has like, you know, aspirations in the children's space. She has like an album that she wrote in 2020 that she just hasn't released yet. She's like, you know, I worked on a children's album once. I was like, really? Ma? You know, so I think that there was some natural overlap. Mm-hmm. But on our album, Ancestars, which just came out in May.
Love this album.
Thank you.
Love this album. As an adult without small children, I love this album.
Thank you so much. Yeah. Thank you so much. And she brings her fullness as a jazz artist.
Yeah.
I bring my fullness in the children's space, and we found natural ways to overlap the two.
Yeah. Yeah. I feel like I could just talk to you all day, and I'm being selfish already because you have many things to do for the people of Sioux Falls. So I did see something online where you just gave your love to LeVar Burton and in the public broadcasting space. Just say something about that kind of role model. And, you know, my connection was reading Rainbow with LeVar. I wasn't a Star Trek person, but boy, I mean, that this the it just changed, you know? Yeah. Like, how did he impact your life growing up? Just seeing him and the kindness that he shared. I feel like we should give LeVar Burton some love here.
Let's give LeVar Burton some love. It is always time to give LeVar Burton some love.
Isn't it? Yeah.
Yeah, I mean, you know, he showed me so many things. I think reading Rainbow and Star Trek and Roots, really, because right. before I really understood, you know, racism, very young age, my grandmother sat me down in front of a box. She had a box set of VHS tapes, you know, of all of Roots. And she had us watching and making sure we understood.
Really?
And that was my introduction to LeVar. And then when I saw him on Star Trek, it was like, whoa, that's the same guy from the thing that my grandma used to watch that I found so annoying, you know, at the time. Like, I'm trying to watch Sesame Street. Like, why are we watching the Roots? But, you know, she was spoon-feeding us this history. Like, she's going to make sure you get your history. But yeah, in reading Rainbow, he's just such a gentle spirit, gentle giant.
Yeah.
And so I have a lot of gratitude for the impact he continues to have in the space of you know, nurturing healthy Black masculinity, loving, educating, and inspiring all Americans and beyond. For decades, just the longevity of this man, all of it is admirable.
Yeah. As a child, when I first saw LeVar Burton, it just seems, you know, he's ubiquitous in all our lives. So I'm like, when was your first time watching reading? Like, I don't remember how old I was. Mm-hmm. But I felt like I had to create a new category for him. Like, he wasn't a father figure. Mm-hmm. He wasn't a brother figure. He wasn't like a teacher. Like, he didn't look or represent like anything in my little life. Mm-hmm. And so he had like his own little space.
Yeah.
And that didn't turn out to be such a bad thing, mm-hmm. for him to have his own little space. He didn't fit into any of the roles that in my mind I had created because of what I had seen and not seen. But there he was.
Yeah.
Just remarkable. Have you met him?
I have met him.
I figured I have not.
Yeah. Wow. Yeah, LeVar Burton, interestingly, last year at the Grammy Awards, my mother and I were both nominated. I was nominated for Best Children's Music Album. My mom was nominated for Best Jazz Vocal Album. And we were at the pre-telecast, you know, because there's like the televised. They only do like 12 categories during the televised portion.
Okay.
Pre-televised is like 6 hours. That's when they do the smaller categories. And LeVar Burton was the host of the pre-telecast. So he got to introduce me and my mom. He mentioned my song. I've written a song inspired by and dedicated to LeVar Burton. He mentioned it. He introduced us, and we got to hang out backstage. We had a blast.
I love that. Thank you for the work that you're doing in the world. We could have talked about artists and politics and public service. We could have talked about the work that you do with kids, your amazing family, and I just I'm so excited to follow your career and see where it goes next. Thank you for coming to Sioux Falls.
Thank you. Sioux Falls is wonderful. I've had a blast here. So thanks for having me and being so hospitable and gracious.
Thanks.